You don't see that. You just don't see that. Period. All right, everybody, before we start, I'm going to eat a bunch of crow, big old bowl of crow. Everything that could have went wrong, because we have a very special guest tonight. And, you know, after 19 episodes of this, you think we'd get our stuff together. Never once had an issue, but of course we do now. So maybe our guest is my kryptonite. I don't know. I don't know what's going on here. But again, we have a I'm Sean.
And this, I'm Steph.
This right here, this lady over here, digging ditches, hitting switches, is Final Cut Steph. We have a very, very special guest on the show tonight. You're watching Rampant Live, and this is the second time we've tried to shoot this episode tonight. We have a writer, director, producer, amazing filmmaker, the man behind Triune Films, the host and the creator of Film Riot, the one, the only, Ryan Connolly. Welcome to the show, Ryan.
Hello. Is it working?
Give me a second.
Now?
We'll find out.
Good Lord in heaven, please work.
Yeah, it'll be more panicking. Or
so. I'll tell you what, guys. If this doesn't work, we're going to take the camera up on the roof, and I'm going to jump off of it. Is it working?
Yes.
Oh, for crying out loud. Technology 2016, ladies and gentlemen.
All right. I'm going to tweet it out and all that. That's
embarrassing. To all of the lovely comments in the YouTube channel, I'm sorry. Things happen. There's nothing I can do about it. You're not nearly as angry as I am embarrassed. So how about that? So we love each and every one of you, but for whatever reason, Ryan jumps on the show and the whole room just goes. So, and this is a permanent set, Ryan. We literally just turned the lights on. And
It's your fault. It's your fault for bringing me on.
It is my fault.
I'm cursed. Everybody knows this. Every project I do is just everything goes wrong. So it was bound to happen.
We have battery backups everywhere, but I'm waiting for the power to go. Like the universe just doesn't want this to happen. So again, YouTubers, sorry. There's an awful lot of comments in there. And Facebookers, well, there's not very many of you. But thank you, everybody, for putting up with our nonsense. I'm sorry we're starting so much later. We scrambled. We cursed. We swore. We cried. But now everything's good. So once again, we have got the world-famous Ryan Connolly on the show. And I cannot thank you enough, my friend, to be on the show. It's, just an honor to have you on the show.
Yes,
for real.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, man, absolutely.
So,
thanks for having
me. If any of you here have questions for Ryan, go ahead and throw them up anytime on the book or on YouTube. But let's just get it started. Everybody knows about Film Riot, but I'd like to know more about Ryan, if that's cool.
If you were a tree.
Which tree would you be?
I don't know many trees. I'd be a palm tree.
Nice. I like how you teed it up and didn't have an answer. I love that. So let's dial it way back, man. When did you wake up and go, you know what? Film is where it's at. I want to write. I want to direct. This is my life, and I'm going to work forever from this point forward. When was that?
I don't know the exact moment when I knew I wanted to be a filmmaker, because it was this evolution of I wanted to be an entertainer. I want to tell stories. And it kind of went like that. The earliest I can think of it being focused on, oh, I want to make films, without actually placing it in films, was about 8 years old when my dad brought home a camera. And before that, I had my little box of props and wardrobe, and I would put on shows for my family. And some of my brothers and sisters, they would join in too. And I just love doing that stuff, having that captive audience and, giving them an experience, making them laugh or whatever. It was always making them laugh when I was younger. I wasn't trying to be Shakespeare at the time. I'm not now either.
Oh, come on.
So it was like that. And then, my dad brought home the camera, and then it was this, I always talk about it because it's such a lingering moment in my mind that I'll never forget. When I looked through the viewfinder and saw that it looks through the lens, and I saw that I can make someone see from my perspective. I can force them to see what I'm seeing. Whereas, and I would just do my stand up in front of everybody type of thing. It was, they're seeing whatever this is. They're not seeing it from my perspective, what's in my head. So that idea that I could try to utilize this tool to force you to see exactly what I want you to see sort of clicked in my 8-9-year-old brain for some reason. And then it was just, I became obsessed with trying to do that. And then it was, anybody who watched my show knows I'm obsessed with Jurassic Park. And it's because that was the movie that made me realize that, oh, directing Steven Spielberg, that's what I want to do. Because it was just, I had never seen a movie like that. A movie that made me feel that way, unsafe in an entirely safe environment. Never felt that way before. I was on this roller coaster ride, even though I'm sitting still in this, theater surrounded by a bunch of people, nothing's going wrong, but I felt, I felt danger, and I wanted to be able to give that experience to an audience. I want to harness that myself. And that's when it really clicked into, directing, and very specifically this sort of thing is what I want to do. And then, I don't know, I just never ever wanted to do anything. I can't remember ever wanting to do anything else than this sort of thing.
I also love Jurassic Park. The soundtrack's probably, who doesn't love John Williams? But the fact that they basically created camera tracking while making Jurassic Park was enough to sell me, man.
Yeah, Spielberg, his films have changed filmmaking several times. What must that be like? He's just a god at that point.
I wonder if he has
a
friend who makes fun of him or jokes with him and is like, hey, what are you gonna pioneer today, huh, buddy? Huh? Come on, man. It's been a week since you've done something amazing. Come on.
I know, right? He maybe be on his pioneer days, possibly. You never know. But
I love Spielberg. So do you obviously subscribe to the theory of watching his movies without audio to see how he tells the story with a camera?
I haven't watched all his films without audio, and it's right. Not just Spielberg's films. Whenever a movie, whenever I'm so engrossed in a movie, like I catch myself like, man, this movie really, really has me. This film, it really, really has me. Or even this sequence of set piece, like really has me. That's when I want to dissect, you know, what did they do to get me there? And that's when I'll do I'll even listen to a movie without looking at it. So I'll do it, you know, either way, just see what the sound's doing. Without looking at picture to really dial into, you know, what they're focusing on, what they're letting me hear and then not hear. So, you know, it's that collection of all those things. So, yeah, I mean, even Godzilla, although in all honesty, isn't like the greatest movie ever, the latest one. I still like it. I think it's fun. But how Gareth Edwards directed that film, how he blocked that film, was fantastic. So I've seen that movie like 20 times, just dissecting his blocking and, you know, how he paced through scenes. So that even that was a movie that I watched with the sound off. So it's not just like highest caliber god filmmakers. It's anything where it gets me to a certain engagement point. I'm kind of wanting to reverse engineer that.
I love that. So would you recommend for someone who wants to be, there's a lot of people in both chat rooms who idolize you, understandably so, who want to be someone like you. So it's one of your main recommendations, just watch as much film as you can, not as an audience member, not appreciating the film itself, but actually dissecting it, like you just said.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think anybody idolizes me. And I'm nowhere yet. False. I'm trying to get there.
114 million views.
You know, I want to make
million
films,
views, my friend.
Yeah, we definitely have like an awesome community of people. That's what's cool about what we have is, like, you know, we never call them fans because I don't think we have fans. I think we have a community that sort of believes in each other, you know, and we watch their stuff and we'll comment, and people send me stuff on Twitter all the time and I love watching it and commenting, and they give us feedback, and it's become like a really great sort of training ground for me, as much as the people who watch our show, because we've been learning. That's what's great. You go back and watch in 2009 and woof, some of the stuff. Man, we've come a long way for sure. But I think that's really cool, is like having that out there to see how green we started. And I had gone to film school. I had been professional in the industry for several years at that point. But still in that avenue, it was so very green. And to watch that evolve is pretty cool. I don't remember your question.
Oh, me neither.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, definitely watch. Of course, watching films and analyzing them is a great way to learn. But there's, you know, there's some pretty great filmmakers who, you know, claim to have not done that, that they just turned on a camera and started doing their thing. You know, some coming from theater and then bringing in, you know, how they tell stories. So I don't think you necessarily need to stand on those shoulders. That's how I do it personally. And I think that's how most people probably do it. But it's really, you know, breaking down, what is a story? How do I tell my story? What does my audience need to see? So it's finding how to create that engagement, that connection with an audience. And if that, the way that you're doing that is technically through breaking down other films and really analyzing them, great. If it's a gut instinct thing, great. I don't think there's one path to it. Whenever anyone, you know, says that this is how you do it, you haven't seen this film and you want to be a filmmaker? Yeah, so I don't want to make that kind of movie. You know what I mean? So I just don't think there's any one road when it comes to anything, entertainment or art. I think there's, I just said this to somebody not long ago. There's many roads that all lead to sort of the same place. It's just finding the right one for you.
So is that what you would tell someone who wants to follow in your footsteps in terms of building their own YouTube audience? I mean, just what is your advice?
Sure. I don't think you can follow in my footsteps though, right? Like I don't think I can follow in anyone else's. I think if you try, eventually you're going to have to get off of that path and onto your own, you know. I mean, I definitely mimicked some people that came before me at first, and I probably still do. I'm still learning and figuring this whole thing out. But eventually, you have to create your own track, right? You got to create your own footsteps, and because otherwise you're just trying to be that person, and it's, you know, it's not unique, it's not valuable. There's already that thing, and how far can you go with that? Lots of people have gone far with that sort of thing, but I think it's more few and far between than the people who are just trying to use their voice. And I think my stuff is definitely, like, when you watch it, I think you can see my influences in my stuff, but I would hope that my voice is very heavy in my stuff, because I'm not trying to be them. I'm just very influenced by them, so it ekes into everything I do. I'm trying to, you know, just make fun stuff. I'm not trying to, you know, be one thing. I'm just trying to be me, you know, carve whatever path I'm going to carve and find my way as I go. So I think if anybody tries to fully follow anyone else's model, it's probably a recipe for failure. Whereas I think instead of following in someone's footsteps, I think you should be inspired by someone's path. How did they do that? Okay, well, that's not exactly what I want to do, but I can take this little piece and that little piece. That makes sense for me. And then you create your own process and your own route.
Yeah, I think it's important to be authentic, and that will show through.
I think that even goes with filmmaking in general. I love hearing people's process, because there's not one person who I've heard their process in full and been like, oh, right, that's how I do things. It's been like, I do that. But no, those things don't resonate with me at all. But this guy, yeah, those things. And it's just these collections of different ideas of how someone does something that kind of piece together, you know, sort of how I might do things. And then I find my own along the way, too. So it's kind of the same thing there as well, if that made any sense. I also got distracted by my lights shutting off on me. Yeah. Oh, no.
They're coming for you.
Sean!
I you know, that's one of the reasons. I've had the pleasure and the honor of being able to work with you a couple times. And the main reason I enjoyed it is seeing how you work and seeing what your process is. And every single director, every single writer, every single producer is 100% different. So it's really great to see, like, you know, when you tell me, oh, this is how I do things. The one thing you all have in common, every director has in common, is this is how I do things. That's exactly how they all are, you know.
Right.
But I really enjoy it. We are just being flooded with questions.
We are.
So let's answer some questions before these people think it's a pre-recorded session here.
All right. Where do you want to start?
Pick one.
All right. So.
All right.
I don't know. You pick one. There's so many.
Oh, good gracious. So Philip Andrew Nichols says, Ryan, what do you do when you're not behind a camera or a computer?
Not behind a camera or a computer?
You're not doing this.
Probably sleeping. No, I mean, hanging out with my wife and daughter, reading, just thinking about film. if I'm not doing filmmaking in some way, I'm usually hanging out with family or watching a movie. But that would be along the same. So if I have nothing to do with film at the moment, I'm hanging out with family.
How do you?
Because, I mean, especially nowadays, I don't really have time.
Yeah, I can't imagine. I mean, you've got a full studio now. You're physically not in your home anymore. You've got a bunch of employees. You've got so many things going on with Triune. You guys are always releasing something.
Yep.
Yeah, it's good, man. It's fun. It's stressful, but I have no complaints.
So
how
do you carve out that family time?
You just got to do it. I mean, I'm still trying to find balance. I'm still not very good at it. And I've talked to a lot of industry friends that kind of it's discouraging to be like they're like, yeah, man, I don't know. I'm still trying to figure it out myself. So I got to the point where, as you know, my wife, she was about to go in labor any day. And then I was just thinking about that and losing that time with family, which, I mean, that's far more important than any movie I could possibly make. I mean, I think people who watch my show know how passionate I am about film. It holds true that what I say about, you know, if you're not so passionate that you would rather live under a bridge or out of your car than not do that thing, then find something else. Well, I am that. I'm definitely that passionate. I lived out of my car for a second just so I could do the thing. But still, even with being that passionate about film, it doesn't hold a candle to family. So I don't want to one day look back and I missed all this time with my daughter and my wife and these really important moments that you can't ever get back. So I just decided to, you know, just make time. Even if I'm like, I do not have time, I need to work late, just decide, you know what, no, I'm going home and I'll figure it out tomorrow. And then I found just by doing that, I just figured it out. You know, the next day I figured out how to make it work. All right, well, go home 2 hours later and go into work 2 hours earlier. They're sleeping anyway. So, you know, sleep less. was one of my solutions. But at least solutions.
You get to, I mean, you're working for yourself, so someone's not dictating when you can see your family, which is a wonderful thing.
Right. Yeah, that's super lucky. I'm very, very lucky with that. I obviously set my own hours. But at the same time, I'm more of a slave to it than if I were working for somebody. So if I was working for somebody else, I would have a 9-to-5. But I don't. I own a company, which, you know, every now and again, I think, why would anyone do this to themselves? I mean, you know. So it's like, it's not a 9-to-5 job. It's a 24/7 job. It never stops. And the second that you think you have a little bit of peace, something hits the fan and it needs your attention, or there's 1,000 questions for you, or, you know, there's these 20 emails that I wasn't able to get to this week. I should probably get to it right now at 1 a.m.
Yeah, I get a lot of emails and texts from you at really crazy hours. So I can imagine.
yeah.
Wow. There's just so many, this is redonkulous how many questions we have. That's awesome. Your people love you. Someone just write, so this is a great one. I'm about to go to film school in about a month. Any advice?
Just work your ass off, man. Like that. I think that advice just applies to anything, no matter what you're doing. Just work your ass off. Be honest and passionate. That's it. Don't be a douche.
That's just good. Be a good person.
Look out. You know, look out for the person next to you. I think that's a big problem, though. You know, I think a lot of people are, you know, not a lot of people, but I've seen people go about it, and I definitely did this, and I had to learn the hard way. Is there's this inherent selfishness that happens, especially when you go to film school and you start learning a little bit, and all of a sudden you think you know everything about film, you know, and you become kind of a film snob for a second until you realize how little you know once you actually start learning. So you know, it's, you know, something that I wish I saw more, which it's definitely with the friends that I keep because I have that no douchebag rule. It's just, you know, people trying to help each other succeed. Don't be jealous of the person next to you. Be excited for their successes and, you know, help lift them up to that next level. And more than likely, they're going to turn around and help pull you up the next rung of the ladder too. So, you know, there you could argue that there is a selfishness in that, sure. But, you know, finding, you know, that ability to be happy for the people around you and to want to work hard for their film too, not just your film, so that they can make the things that they want to make. That stuff will really come around to you. What goes around definitely does come around. That has been extremely true in my career. So working hard, I think, just isn't enough. Just being a good person and caring about the people you work with and for is an absolute must. So especially in film school, because you're going to have all those classmates and they're going to want to make their films and they're going to ask you, hey, come out for my film. And you might not want to do it because you don't, it might not be good. We'll go out for his film and he'll come out for yours. Beyond that, just, you know, don't go there to party, go there to learn.
That's interesting that you said that. You and I both went to the same film school, and I don't know how to put this delicately. There are people who complain about all film schools in general, and there are people who complain about that one in general, or specifically. I agree with what you said, though. Yeah. If you go there to work your ass off, it you'll get what you pay for. But if you just show up to class, you're doing yourself a disservice.
Yeah. Yeah, man. I mean, everybody knows I went to Full Sail, and there was a lot of complaints about Full Sail while I was there, and complaints about Full Sail when I left, and I never really understood it. I mean, at the time, Full Sail wasn't like this school that was trying to teach you, you know, the psychology behind storytelling, or, you know, anything super in depth like that, or how to write. They had a writing class, but it's a very technical school. And that is specifically, for better or worse, what I wanted. I wanted a technical school that would teach me where the buttons were and how to wrap my mind around that, so I could leave and become my own storyteller without somebody putting ideas in my head about how to tell a story or write a story or whatever. They've definitely evolved more and have a lot more to them with that now. But I think what happened was, from my perspective, from being there, is you have like these kids that go there that a lot of them never touched a camera before, which blew my mind. Didn't know anything about filmmaking. I had been making short films for like 13 years at the time. So there was no doubt in my mind that this is what I wanted to do. And I knew how much time went into it and how it wasn't very glamorous. It was just a lot of work and then waiting and then work and then waiting. So these kids didn't know what they were getting into, and they sort of hated it. And the hours are crazy, sort of like the industry. And a lot of them hated the hours. And then, you know, while I was home studying, they were out partying, and then they just didn't get that much from it, and then complained that they didn't get a lot from it. But you know, they weren't putting a lot into it, which I didn't get. Like, even, you know, they would have the labs. And you had, like, this four-hour lab. And it would happen almost every time without fail. It was, like, mandatory. You had to be there for an hour, and then you could leave if you wanted. And almost every time without fail, after 1 hour, it was me and the instructors only. All the other students were gone. It happened so many times. And I remember one time it was just me, a 16 mil camera, and all the instructors. And I was like, this is
best
awesome.
School ever.
Yeah, so I had like a solid two and a half hours with a 16 mil camera, you know, a test load of film and my instructors. And I just sat there learning to load the film and, you know, practicing carrying it around to do handheld. And so, you know, what you put into it, I couldn't speak to what the school is now. I haven't been there. You know, you could argue, is film school really needed nowadays? Of course, you could do that. But, you know, everything in life is what you put into it.
It's interesting that you said that, because that's our follow-up question. We ask every guest on the show, is film school necessary? In 2016, it's the greatest time to be alive as a filmmaker. You can build your own audience. You can broadcast to, you know, millions of people. You can learn everything. You can go on Film Riot and learn quite a bit and become a really talented filmmaker just from Film Riot. You could also go on Lynda. You can go, you know, there's all kinds of places you can go without ever stepping foot into a film school. So do you believe that film school is necessary in 2016?
I don't know. I mean, some of the most talented filmmakers I know didn't go or kind of went or, you know, went to something that was, you know, had nothing to do with filmmaking and are now an unbelievable filmmaker. So you definitely film school isn't a must to be a filmmaker. Definitely not, especially nowadays. Like back in the day when I went to back in the day, it was a Thursday, by the way. When I went to Full Sail, it was like, you know, there wasn't any info out there at all. It was so difficult to find any information on anything. It was like all magicians and their secrets type stuff. So, you know, film school was like kind of a must back then unless you knew people. But now it's definitely not the case. Now I think it just depends on the person, which is also with almost everything. It's like, you know, film school offers you a very focused, dedicated, you know, space of time that you're going here to 100% focus all your energy and attention on, you know, crafting this one thing, becoming this one thing. And you're never going to get that time back because then you enter the real world and you need a job and, you know, all that stuff. And it also is great for networking. You're going and you're locking in with people who are like-minded for you for that period of time that then you could carry throughout your career. Depending on the film school you go to, some, you know, are better than others, of course. But, you know, these people are the ones that, you know, might get you jobs later on down the road. I definitely wouldn't count on any film job placement or film school job placement. I don't know of any of them that are all that good from what I've heard. But, you know, there's some good reasons to go to film school. But, you know, advice that I'm often giving to people is, you know, if you can, give it a year of you just busting your ass and trying to make it happen and just going for it and see what happens. PA like crazy on anything you can possibly get on. And you do that and somebody sees how hard you work and how good you are to work with and they're going to, you know, tell somebody about you and then all, you're on the next gig and then the next gig and the next gig. And maybe you turn around and you're like, oh, I don't need film school. I basically put myself through film school by working through experience, which is a better film school in my opinion. But if that doesn't work out after that year, you know, then consider film school.
I agree with you. I know a lot of people who went that route and now they're in the camera department or the art department and, you know, they look back and go, I'm not sure how I got here, but I'm glad I am, you know? Yeah. So yeah,
totally.
I mean, hard work.
Totally.
I mean, for those of you who do know Ryan, you said that when you graduated from film school, you didn't immediately get into work. You actually ended up working construction for a while to pay for your own gear, which I love about your story.
Yeah. When I left, a lot of my instructors and people that were giving me advice wanted me to go to LA or New York. And, you know, that makes a lot of sense, of course. But I knew that, especially at the time, if I would have gone there, it would have just been one of a million people just like me trying to do something. And I'm very, very family oriented, as you know, because half my company is my family. They help me with everything that I do. So I didn't want to leave, you know, my then girlfriend who I knew I wanted to marry and my whole family to go off and pursue this career and just leave all that behind. I just couldn't stomach that. So I was like, you know what, let me see if I can carve my own path. And if I can't, then I'll consider LA and New York. So then just right away, I just took as much work as I possibly could, making money however I could so I could build up my gear. And that was construction. I did auto detailing. You know, I had tech support job, like anything I could do. I had like three jobs at one point just so I could build up that gear. And then once I got the gear, then I was, you know, tacking on freelance work, which I wasn't even getting paid for. I would just do anything anybody needed just so I could build up a reel, created that reel, and then just started sending it out like crazy. And then, you know, I think it took about 2 years probably of that until I finally one day was fed up and then sent my resume and reel that I was able to build up over time to, like, I think it was, I don't remember exactly. It was definitely over 100, but I think it was about 100, 150 companies. And literally one called me back, and that was Alienware. They happened to be, and it wasn't even Alienware. It was a production company that worked with Alienware, and Alienware was asking them if they knew of anybody who, you know, be willing to run their video studio. And that production company was like, "Hey, this kid just sent us his resume. Check it out." And that's how I got that job. And then I did that for 3 years.
For 3 years, wow. Okay.
Yeah. Which that was a great training ground too, because they let me build out the studio however I want, got any of the gear, whatever gear I wanted. And then it was just, you know, when I wasn't doing what they wanted, you know, talking head videos, product videos, whatever it was, I was able to just go experiment and come up with different ideas to do different, you know, a different way to shoot this laptop to make it look cooler, a different technique for, you know, utilizing this camera motion or whatever. Worked on VFX a lot. That's where I learned After Effects, was doing a lot of that sort of stuff, which was a lot of bubble gum and popsicle sticks back then, before Element 3D.
No doubt. E3D was a lifesaver.
So you were talking about production equipment and stuff to get started. And we had a question earlier. What is the best way to do that? What is the best way to start your, basically building your collection of everything that you need to be a filmmaker?
you know, working your butt off to earn the money for it. And then, you know, just piece by piece. I started with a camera, and then I moved to lighting, and then I moved to audio. And then it was just piece by piece, like slowly over time. And that's still what I do. Any project we do, if we have a sponsor on board that has a budget, I'll try to buy some stuff when I can instead of rent it. That way now we just have it. And then, you know, at the end of the year with, you know, tax write-off money, you know, you try to buy some gear. So it's just slowly, piece by piece. So how old am I now? 34. So for 10 years now, I've been building out my gear. So people are like, "Look at all the gear he has." I'm like, "It's taken me 10 years. For 10 years, it's not that much gear,
Ryan Connolly,
actually.
You bought this last week. Come on. Amazon, 2-day Prime.
Yeah. All of the gear.
Where's the add all to cart button?
It is great whenever you get, like, when you're ever able to get, like, a nice influx of gear. It's just like Christmas. Yeah, but it's just like, it's just like grip gear. It's like C-stands, and you're like,
we just got B&H delivered a bunch of C-stands. They're sitting in our hallway in the box. Hasn't even opened. Oh, it is great.
It's great. You're like, let's set up every single one of them. Because why
because
not?
Because we can. Make our neighbors wonder, what is that? So you mentioned family. Yeah. Let's talk about working with family. We're a family business, although this is it. It's a lot smaller than yours. But how did you wake up one day and go, you know what? I really want to involve my family in this thing that I'm doing.
It was born out of necessity, I guess. I never really thought about it that way. I mean, definitely once I, you know, sat down and thought about, hey, I want to create a company and I'm actually going to create a company. A part of that would be, it was like, man, it would be so cool if I could get most of my family to work for and with me. That way it would kind of keep us all together. Cause that, you know, that's a great way to, like, you know, lose touch with friends and family is, you know, everybody goes off and does their own thing and has their own careers. And it's hard to kind of stay connected. And, you know, that was like a cool idea. That'd be awesome. But as it turns out, they all have all these very specific skill sets that were like perfect. Like, hey, I do need that. So it's, you know, it's been really great to work with all of them. And obviously we all get along, which I guess isn't an obvious thing. Some family members don't get along as well. So I guess we're lucky there. But it's been a lot of fun, man. And it's like, you know, when I first started just doing short films, I just annoyed them with like, hey, can you come help me? Can you hold this boom mic? Can you help me carry lights from here to there? And, you know, my whole family, to their credit, just unbelievable individuals, always believed in me and was always like, yeah, man, sure. I'll blow an entire weekend on carrying lights for you. Why not?
That's amazing.
So, that is awesome. You know, I'm definitely, it's not lost on me how lucky
it's
I
obvious
am,
you all are very close and care about one another. That you can see that in the dynamic of the few that we do see on camera.
Yep.
You can see that things are very genuine.
Yeah, they're good. They're good people. I don't mind them. The good peeps.
How did you just go up in one day and say, you know, I want my sister, my little sister, to play a murderous, vengeful character?
That was an accident, actually. It was that episode. It's pretty funny. I'll never forget that episode specifically because everybody who usually helped me at the time, Tim Allen, my brother Josh, a couple of friends, went to, I think Warped Tour, maybe? I don't remember. It was this, I don't do well in crowds. When it's like a big crowd, I like stress out. I'm like, this is too much. Get me out of here. So it's just this huge outdoor music festival. And they all went to that. And I'm like, no, thank you. And I got to do Film Riot anyway. But I had no help. And I had, you know, only the weekend to do it because then that was when I had my full-time job at Alienware. And I lived in Weston. They lived in West Palm Beach, which was about an hour drive. So I only had the weekends to shoot with them. So I had to get it done in the weekend. So I had no one to shoot with. So I was like, well, Emily, what if you were in it and you were this character? And then we just did this small part and she was hilarious. And I'm like, oh man, what if I just put you in the whole thing then? And then it just kind of evolved that way. But that episode, the person holding the boom mic was a 10-year-old. The person doing the camera when I was on camera was, I think at the time, 12. So it was me. I even took a picture of it. It was me and literally this crew of 12 nice. And under ages. It was hilarious. It was just my two sisters, Emily and Amanda, and my nephews. And that's how I shot that episode amazing. Of Film Riot. It's like if people knew, especially in the beginning, half the way I did Film Riot, it would be
that's what I love.
Pretty
though.
Funny.
I love that about your story. You're not shooting from, you know, a fully funded studio with all this great gear and a union crew, you know.
Yeah. Especially in the beginning, there was a good portion of time when I stopped working at Alienware that I had this like literally home video camera that Revision 3 sent me because I didn't have my camera anymore. It busted on me. So we didn't have a camera to use. So Rev 3 sent me this home video camera, like legitimately a home video camera that you would never use. And it's not like now where your iPhone is actually a pretty solid camera right. that you could make look filmic. This was that 30 frames per second, clearly filming my daughter's birthday home video camera. And that's what we had to shoot Film Riot on for a while. And where we shot stand-ups was up against a wall in my mom's house that I just blasted with light to try to make white. And so it was in this house where people always were there. So it was always a matter of like trying to get the stand-ups done before someone said something and literally having those moments of, Mom! Mom! I'm shooting my show, Mom! Yes, I want pizza! Pepperoni! Pepperoni, Mom! All right, let's go again. So it was like definitely... and that was a big period of time, too. Like, where it's just like, I'm literally like in a bathroom that I don't own shooting. This is my career. yeah. I messed up many a houses too. And when we did, my parents are so patient with me. They're wonderful humans. When we did tell, we like broke tile on their tub. I burnt their wall with a 1K. I think it's in the like behind the scenes that we made. We like there's this huge burn mark on the wall from a 1K. Somebody just pointed a 1K at the wall. Never me. Pointed a 1K at a wall to bounce. Which ended up, people are like, what's that smell? It sounds like somebody's like doing wood burning, arts and crafts. Like, what is that? And everybody's like, I don't know. And then we look at the wall and there's just this little steam rising off of it. I almost turned into Naked and Afraid for a moment. It was like, we get it to ignite.
I don't know how you clean up the mess and tell. I mean, I just saw just the tile scene in the kitchen. I'm just like, oh, I don't know how you did that.
Every crack. Worse than that was... we did right in the, actually we shot it before Film Riot went online and we released it before Film Riot went online was PMS the horror movie, which was worse before it went online with Rev 3 because with Rev 3 we got better licensed music. So I was able to switch out the music, whereas before I composed the whole thing through GarageBand. It was so bad. It was so bad. So that one was the worst one ever. We had blood, and my parents were just cool with it. I don't. Now that I'm older, I'm like, how are they just cool with it?
Parents on the planet.
I literally had one of those like lawn sprayers, you know, those like pesticide sprayers or whatever, and I filled it with blood, and I'm just spraying it inside their house, and they're just like, that's cool. I don't know why. They didn't know. I don't think I ever told them what I was doing. Maybe they just like found out later and was like, whatever.
You have the most amazing parents. I know I probably would have been disowned.
What's funny was, I think it was like 3 or 4 years later, they move out of that house and we found blood all over the wall from PMS the Horror Movie.
Awesome.
When there was this moment that they were like, the guys were like hanging out this window and then we like spray them with all this blood. Well, that wall behind them is red. So we didn't realize it. So we're moving out and I'm like, what's this? And there's just blood all over the wall. So
that's great for resale value too, really.
Yeah. What happened here?
Actually, right now it would be great. This is from Film Riot.
You ever seen Jack?
$100,000 more. So yeah. Good gracious, man. Because we're about to shoot a blood volume, as we've been talking, and we're scared to death that if we end up shooting it here and Steph comes out in a jumpsuit covered in blood, we're straight up gonna get arrested. I just know it.
It's gonna happen.
I just know it.
Dude, I feel that way so many times. We only got the cops called on us, I think once, maybe twice. Once for sure. Once where it was like, it was an issue. When we shot the, way, way back in the day, we did this sketch with Emily. I think it was like maybe her second or third sketch, where she's trying to shoot an apple off of Josh's head. So she's shooting at Josh, and Josh keeps getting shot. And we're shooting in the backyard of my brother's house. So Josh is screaming things like, stop shooting me with bullets. I'm bleeding. Stuff like that. Just at the top of his lungs. Just, stop shooting me with bullets! Like that type of stuff. And we're doing it for hours. And then my sister's now husband was kind enough to just bring us an extension cord from my parents' house. So he brings the extension cord and he leaves. And he gets trailed by the cops because they see him leaving the house. And they pulled him over and like held him for like, I think it was like 2 hours, questioning him like crazy. What are you doing? And then they sent like someone to the house to corroborate his story and check everything out. We had to show him like the video. Like, no, it's... we're just doing a thing. Look,
you
catch up.
No,
it's
man,
fine.
I've never heard of him.
But yeah, he was like, I should have. But he was like stuck for like 2 hours, and he anything. He just brought us a cord. I was like, yeah, suck it.
I love that. I love how real. You know, the thing I love about what you guys do is you make yourself vulnerable, and you're very approachable. Not many people are willing to do that. A lot of people really don't like giving away the quote unquote secret sauce. And I love how you give it all away.
Yeah, I mean, I've prescribed the idea that no one can be me and I can't be you. It's impossible. The reason I make the things the way that I make them isn't necessarily, you know, the tactics that I employed to make it, but it's everything that makes up me as a person. So it's all the experiences that have come before that I've had over my entire life and how I see the world. And what I find funny, what I find scary, what makes me cry, those are the things that make up what my voice is, not the fact that I like to have the camera a little bit lower and I put the key on the opposite side and I diffuse it all the time and I like to keep haze in it. No, those are things that everybody does. It's how you personally perceive those things that makes you the filmmaker that you are. So no, I don't think anybody can truly copy paste that. And I think if anybody does, it feels it doesn't feel authentic. Like think about anybody trying to be Wes Anderson. Even if they nail the style, it doesn't feel quite right. It just feels like a copy. So it's like, you know, that's what I'm always telling people. Like it's like, man, it's totally cool to like, I've done it. I've made several short films in the past where it was clearly a ripoff of a movie that I saw and loved. And it's like, you know, that's fine to do that, to learn and everything. But at some point, you know, you got to purposefully not do those things anymore and just be you and create your thing and carve your path.
How do you get the right action out of your actor, especially when they're a family member? How are you get, because I mean, I just showed Stephanie the, First of all, I love Portal Kombat. Some of the one-liners and Josh's acting is just, when Josh falls off the bike, I damn near wet myself. And then the Doritos is just enough to make you want to cry. And then
you have
these little
part.
One-liners on there too, like the assisted suicide line. That's so under the radar, but it's so damn funny. You know, how do you get that kind of comedic timing down from family members?
You know, some of it's, you know, in the editing and the directing and, you know, how exactly I shoot it and all that. But I mean, more than anything, it's just who you're picking to deliver those lines. And Josh and Emily are hilarious. So they, you know, putting them in front of the camera does 90% of my job. And then after that, it's just a matter of me sort of helping them get to the place that they need to get to best utilize this moment. So it's like, you know, I get this actor who I know is best for this moment. Or for this scene, for this short, whatever. And then I create the atmosphere that they need to perform in the way that I know that they can. And then if they're having a bit of a misstep, if they're making wrong choices that aren't servicing that piece as a whole, that it's becoming its own little unified thing that's self-serving and not serving the film, then it's my job to help guide them back this way a little bit. But I try not to be too precious about it. I do have a tendency to be a little bit Hitchcockian, where I make the thing before I make the thing sometimes. And it's just like, this is how I hear it. This is how I want it said. And I want it said like this because I know it'll be funny if it's said like this. So I've always tried to, you know, over the past few years when I recognized that I did that, try to steer away from that and know that there's several different ways that line that can be said and you'll still get that same intention. I've talked about that a lot on the show lately too. And in shorts like Portal Kombat or Proximity, stuff like that, I've gone into sort of purposefully, well, Proximity, it wasn't so much on purpose as it was just I didn't have time to prep it. We wrote and shot it in 10 days. But stuff like Proximity Losses, which I really hate, some of the Action Month stuff, I purposefully, just to challenge myself and to learn, didn't prep it at all and just stepped on set and just followed where it wanted to go. And that makes it a little bit easier to not be so precious, because you have your intention of what you want each moment to do based on what you want your audience's experience of that moment to be. And then, you know, you move around that. What's going to create that atmosphere to allow my audience to have, you know, the experience that I'm hoping to create for them. But when I do something like Tell is the best example, because Tell, I storyboarded every single shot. And Tell is the only production I've ever done where it was very, very close to what my plan that I sent out for was. It was like 90% probably, whereas everything else is maybe 20% of what I had in my head. It just became something else entirely. So, you know, it's just a matter of creating that atmosphere and letting them play. Let them surprise you. Something I'll do often if it's in a, you know, if it's with an actor that I trust or I think is really funny or I think has really good instincts, it's like, well, you know what, let's just run it. Let me see what you do with it and let's go from there. And then oftentimes it'll be like, man, that's not how I saw that moment, but that's exactly, yeah, that's it. And then if it's not, it's a matter of not telling them to, no, do it like this. Sometimes some people like that, but instead it's like, you know, this line's sort of like this. What you're really saying is this, joking around if it's a comedy and getting them comfortable and then, you know, helping that unfold.
When did you?
I don't think that's a very specific answer, but I think that's the best answer I can give, because it really does, like, for me, directing every situation, especially who the people are that you're working with, even at a DP level, you know, the different cinematographers that I've worked with, I work with them very differently from each other because they're totally different types of people with different types of style that bring a different perspective. So it's very different relationships to each other. So it's I think, you know, a director is sort of mommy, daddy, psychologist sort of or sort of thing, or a therapist rather in some ways. But I guess we all are on set to some degree. If you have anybody underneath you, that's kind of how you need to approach it, I suppose.
No, I agree completely. Do you come up with specific DPs in mind when you have a project, or is it based on availability? Or if availability was different, would you change the shooting style to match their abilities, or how does that work for you?
I mean, you know, I'm still in a place where I don't really have the luxury to be too picky. I always have my "this is how I would love to make this happen" sort of thing. Sure. And usually just it works out if I'm like, man, this is how I really want to make this, it just works out because I know what's available to me. So I'm still at a place where, you know, I can't be precious about very much. We operate on very low budgets. You know, we were talking about before, Action Month was, you know, really 1/10, maybe less of the budget we actually needed to pull off something like that. But we were just being ambitious and just going for it. Lots of beg, borrowing, stealing stuff happening there without the stealing.
You stole the helicopter, didn't you, Ryan?
Maybe. I got the diamonds. So, yeah, I mean, a lot of it's based off of, you know, what I have available to me at the time. But so far, it's all worked out really well. The only times it hasn't, when, you know, I couldn't get, like, proximity, I didn't really have much of a crew, so I had to do a lot of those. I was DP and director, which I don't prefer to do. I'm not a cinematographer. I'm a very visual director, I think, but I'm not a cinematographer. That's not what I do. I can maybe get it 50% of the way. I cannot do what, like, Ryan Booth and Josh Knepper and, you know, all those guys do. That's just a totally different skill set that I don't have. And Ryan Booth is a cinematographer and a director, but that's not me. I fall in the writer, producer, director, editor sort of range. Those are the things that I do. I can do the rest, especially since I think if you're a director, you should know all the jobs on set, and I'm constantly trying to learn them more, just so, you know, for the same reason of if you're going to direct actors, you should be in front of the camera at some point. You should know what that feels like, because I think there are a lot of directors that don't know what that feels like and they're not sensitive enough toward what their actors are going through. It's a very vulnerable place to be in front of that lens, in front of that whole crew, and be asked to pour your heart out in that way. Even when it's comedy, you know, you're really putting it out there, regardless of what the genre is. So to know what that feels like is really, really important. And I think that, you know, goes across every avenue of filmmaking. Every position on that crew is to know what they're going through, to what their job is. You're not asking too much of them. You're being sensitive towards what their job is like on their day to day. And you're more appreciative because you know how hard it is to do this thing that you're doing. You're not just saying, I don't understand why it takes so long to do blah, blah. You're like, I get how hard that is. Thank you for moving fast, but we only have 5 minutes, so could you move faster?
Because I've been on music video sets where directors have said, yeah, I know your job is hard. I mean, just straight up mocking you in front of the crew, and that's brutal. Absolutely brutal.
And I do not understand that. I don't understand, unless someone's being a douche, but even then, I've had small issues. Luckily, I haven't had any blowouts on set or anything like that, but I've had small, you know, attitude issues or people being out of line and saying stuff in front of the crew or whatever. But I don't understand, you know, calling them out in front of it. For me, it's always take them aside. Let's talk about this. You know what I mean? I don't understand belittling people. I don't get how that's going to get your end result. As a director, you want to create this team of people that are like willing to go the extra mile, to not just do their job, but to go a little bit further for right. you, for the team, you know, not just you. And I think that's maybe a part of the problem with some people is like they see it as this is my film, you know, they're working for me instead of this is our film. We're working together to create this thing that in the end, hopefully we can all be proud of, you know, from crafty all the way to, you know, director, producer. And when we did Action Month, you know, it's like I try to go out of my way to like, make sure, you know, people are huffing heavy crap up and down 6 flights of stairs. You know, I'm trying to, you know, if I can go and do that with them to always keep that perspective. Cause I think that's really important. No douchebags, including me, you know, as much as possible. I heard about that recently where a director kind of called his actors out in front of the whole crew saying that their performances were not so great. I don't understand that. And I've seen that happen too. It's just not my style anyway.
I think nowadays you have to be careful. You know, the whole Christian Bale thing, the guy just went ahead and hit record, you know?
Right? Yeah. Social justice, man. Happens quick and swift. Yeah.
So we had a question. Great. Speaking of acting, question that was, do you have any tips for shy people trying to do a YouTube show kind of thing?
Stop being shy. I'm incredibly shy, actually. Like in person, I had to recognize that about myself. I'm kind of a timid, sort of introverted person, oddly enough. Once you get to know me, I'm not. I'm very loud and I never stop. I do have that ADHD thing going on. But when I don't know someone, it can be difficult for me to have a conversation. I'm just inherently a shy person, oddly enough. But in front of the camera, it's a totally different thing. You know what I mean? It's like this different world entirely, and it's safe there for me. So it's like a different – or behind the camera. If I'm holding a camera, I feel like I could do anything, go anywhere. Nothing can harm me. I'm invincible, which, you know, has been dangerous a time or two. But, you know, I think you just need to get over that. It's not the same sort of shyness as it is in person with human beings. So, you know, if it's just you in a room with a camera, if it's that type of YouTube show, then, you know, what are you afraid of? Just do it. And if it sucks, delete it and try again. If you're in front of the camera and there's crew, then, you know, just rip off the Band-Aid, man. Just do it. Just do it. And you'll see that there's nothing to be afraid of, and just keep doing it. And eventually it'll hurt a little bit less.
And along those lines for YouTube, how do you deal with haters and hugging your haters, that kind of stuff?
That's get so much hate, especially at the beginning of this broadcast. Oof.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't bother me too much. I mean, obviously when you work really, really hard on something and then somebody just dismisses it and this just straight up sucks and you're lazy, this is lazy filmmaking, blah, blah, and you're like, man, you don't know how much work went into this. Just because you didn't like it doesn't make it lazy. This is countless hours, blood, sweat, and tears. I get you don't like it, but you know that stuff sucks when it's just they're dismissing you like that. But you know, not liking it, there's, you know, our audience often will be like, hey, I didn't like this. I think you should have done it this way, and that stuff doesn't bother me at all. Sometimes I agree, sometimes I disagree, but I always pay attention to it because I love those perspectives. And you have to keep in mind sometimes, you know, and I'm talking purely about constructive currently. That you know, especially with like say comedy or horror or whatever, this could not be this person's cup of tea. You gotta, you know, even when you're showing someone a script, you gotta understand what sort of thing that they're into. If you're showing someone a horror script that hates horror movies, probably not gonna get great feedback from this person. It's the wrong person to show. So you gotta keep in mind that there is that avenue of it where there's, you know, those people that this thing's probably not for them, and we have it week to week. We'll have people being like, best episode of Film Riot ever. And other people being like, what happened to Film Riot? It sucks now. And then the next week, it'll be reversed. You know, it's just because they didn't like that particular episode. But the straight up haters, the trolls, as we like to call them, I usually respond to them because I honestly think that there's either one of two things happening. One, they're just really, I don't know, not great people trying to get a rise out of you. Which I don't like to leave unchecked either, because I just think that's a bad influence to the community. And I think, you know, by addressing it, you know, coming at it at a place of, you know, at risk of sounding cheesy, but coming at it from a place of like love and just being like, hey, man, you know, it's not really how we like to interact here. That's no way to talk to somebody you don't even know, you know, that sort of thing. But I honestly think that the majority of them, in my opinion, there's something going on in their life, man. Like, there's no one's that mad about a YouTube video that's free. Come on. Something's going on in that person's life to make them really unhappy. And it may come off disingenuous in the comments, but it's really not. I really feel, you know, bad for them, and I want their life to be better. So often I'll comment that way and be like, hey, man, I don't know what's going on in your life right now that's making you act this way, but I really hope it gets better. Hoping that, A, for a moment they're like, hey, you know, this dude doesn't even know him and he cares. And B, they're like, maybe that's not how I should interact with people because these are also our people, you know. And then I just think, you know, the community sees that, and it's good, I think, to remind us, all of us, that there's a human person on the other side of that monitor on a keyboard of their own, and you know, they have feelings just like you do. So I mean, that's how I like to do it. It's like, why throw gasoline on fire? You know, for me, it's always just, you know, throw as much water on it as I possibly can. Sometimes it's a grease fire and it doesn't do a damn thing. But you know, right away, you know, you respond to them with love, they come back even more hateful. I just go quiet. I just leave it alone there. I did my thing. You know, hopefully that was a good influence to like some young kid who's going through the comments, and instead of reading a bunch of like angry, vicious crap, he has at least that one influence of like, oh, maybe there is a better way to interact, because we have that like disconnect online, right? We've had for that. I think it's, you know, it's definitely growing pains of this new sort of culture of figuring out how to interact online when there is that disconnect. There's no eye to eye there. It's this digital thing that's not, you know, blood and skin, but it is. So I think it's just, you know, something that needs to be corrected. And I think if more people would do that, I think it would be corrected faster.
No, I don't know. I saw you do this very recently, and I took a step back and said, Steph, we need to adopt this thought process. It's great, because my first inclination is to stand up, flip the desk over, and yell, let's do this. You know, probably not the best solution.
No, I definitely have those moments, you know, when you work hard on something and somebody's that vicious. Because some people brutal. Can be, the only times that I get pissed is when they're bashing my crew or my family, or, you know, some people can be pretty filthy about women online, and that gets me going pretty. But those dudes, I don't even respond to them. I just block. I block report. Because, I mean, that level of freaking degenerate is just there's no point.
No.
Yeah. That's like a whole new level of disrespect and ridiculousness that just needs to be flagged. So with that stuff, I don't even bother with that. But you can call me stupid, untalented, fat, ugly, whatever you want. I don't care. I'll be like, hey, friendo. That's fine.
We've had some of that situation with people saying stuff about Steph just to say it. I'm like, nope.
Yeah, man, I don't understand. So, I don't get it.
Bringing it back to more of a tech question, Bill Dowling here says, what do you guys on here think about lighting? Is fluorescent or LED the way to go, and are they only useful for a short distance?
LED lights are great. It depends on the types that you get. They'll be just as powerful and just as good as any other kind of light. They all have different qualities. I love fluorescent lighting. Kinos are some of my favorite lights. I just love the quality of light that those have. LEDs coming a long, long way. I have this like PAR LED that I've been messing around with that's going to have a Fresnel lens for it. And there's a ton that have it that way. And the ability to change the white balance on them and to dim them right on the unit the way that you can, it's really great. So I love LED technology. I love fluorescent. I love old school lighting, you know, the old school like Mole Richardson lights and Airy lights, and I even have some old school low lights, and even those clamp lights from Home Depot. Man, I use them on every single project. I love talking about it because when we did UFO Yab, that opening shot with Josh, Booth lit that entire thing. I don't think we used a single professional light. He used a light bar that I made from a bathroom fixture. He used a fan light that was already in the room, and he just diffused it. He used this like $20 LED lantern that I got from Target, and clamp lights, and it looks gorgeous. And we had like an $18,000 light that we rented just sitting outside lonely. And I'm like, why did I even get that? We used it later, but I had Kinos there, and originally he set up Kinos, and he's like, I don't like how this is looking. And he took it down, you know, this $4,000 light, took it down and grabbed this $20 lantern. And I'm like, when he did that, I'm like, this dude, we're going to work together a lot more. I just love that thinking. You don't need all these tools. You don't need obviously, you know, sometimes you do need them depending on how wide of a throw you need. And it does make it easier. The sharper the knife, the easier the cut. But even with a dull knife, you can get it done. It's just going to take a little bit more elbow grease, you know. So I love people that can think that way and they don't need the tools. They can still have amazing results.
I love the
results.
Look that you created with the clamp lights on the porch. That was unbelievable.
That was great.
That was all Booth, man. He was just like, you know what, let's do this. And I'm like, you genius. It was just awesome. And it went from being like, yeah, this is a cool shot, to Booth, you son of a bitch. It's just gorgeous. I love that man. That beautiful, beautiful man.
He's fantabulous. Matt Haslam here says, why would you choose to do short films when all of the quote-unquote money is in the small market industry and video work?
You know, that is not necessarily true. There, you know, there's business models to anything if you can find it. And, you know, we've found it to sustain ourselves and to continue the current business model that we're doing. And short films is a huge part of that. But on top of that, short films for me is my training ground. every short film I do is another film school, and I've learned way more. Like the action month that we did, I was able to shoot action how I've always wanted to shoot it for the first time ever, and I was able to work with a stunt team, and man, I drank that up. I went to the school O Trevor Addy, my stunt coordinator, and just everything that they were doing, the rigging, and I was just listening to every call they were making and really diving into, you know, what is it to make a film this way and to utilize these guys and to work with them. So I, you know, I have that checkbox now. Okay, worked with stunt team, got it. And every film that we do, I try to bring in something that I've never done before to, you know, learn that avenue as well. So when we get to the place where I'm like, okay, yes, I'm ready for my feature. And I mean, I don't think I'm ever going to be ready for a feature. I've talked about this with friends too. It's like marriage. You're never ready for marriage, but you're ready as you're going to be. And I definitely think I'm at the point now where I'm ready for a first feature. I just haven't landed on what it's going to be just yet, but I think it's right around the corner. And short films are just a great training ground. You go, you piece it together, pre-pros 10,000 times shorter, you shoot it real quick in a couple of days, and then you do your post on it and you're done. You learn from this quick bite-sized little nugget of filmmaking and you move on to the next one. Instead of planting your feet before you're really ready. I mean, if it was with a studio, that'd be one thing, because you get a gig with a studio as a director and they surround you with all these veterans that are now teaching you and guiding you through this process so you can just be the director and, you know, help your vision see it through. But you're surrounded by all these people to help you get there. But when you're in the indie market, you're wearing almost every single hat. The buck falls with you alone almost. So it's a very, very different beast. And I'm not looking to jump into that before I'm ready and deliver something that is not so great, because I should have kept, you know, doing these short films. Like I said, now I think I've hit the point where I'm confident to where I think now we're ready. We could take on a feature. So now we've been shifting that way and sort of building that business model of what will that look like. And, you know, if the opportunity arose for me to go off and make a feature for someone else, I would absolutely love to do that, especially from, you know, the learning standpoint of it. But we're also actively pursuing, you know, what would this look like if we did it ourselves? How would we get, you know, the funding for it? And then how would we distribute it all by ourselves? But I think, you know, I know of a few people that have made the mistake of just right out the gate, jumping right into a feature, and then spending all this time doing this one project and only learning off one project. Whereas if you shrink that down, make it 2 to 5 minutes, and you do a ton of them, now you're getting all these different lessons instead of this one really long one. At least that's the way I did it.
You're not entirely sure what your feature would be, but do you have an idea of what genre it would be?
Not necessarily. I currently have three that might be it, and I'm writing right now. I'm doing a vomit pass on something, which is interesting because I wasn't planning on writing it. It wasn't even an idea that I had. I have three that are like potential first features. One, I just had to throw out because it's basically 90% Stranger Things. So when I watched Stranger Things, I was crying, man. It's an idea I've had for like the last 3 years. And I was even watching it with my wife, and I won't say anything just in case people haven't seen it. And I kept turning her being like, if this is what happens next, I'm jumping out the window. And then like word for word, what I said to her happened. And I'm like, if this is what they explain that this is, that's it. You're a single mother. And then that's what happened. There was even this one scene that was like it blew my mind. It was like beat for beat. I wrote it. I wrote the scene because I was excited about it. I've had it since I was a kid because I read it in this like YA novel or whatever, and I've always wanted to do a scene like it. And it's in there. And even the 80s vibe, that old Spielbergian 80s Twilight Zone sort of vibe, that's what it was. So I was like, this can't be. So that one's out, unfortunately. So now I just have two ideas that I like, but there's this another idea that just popped into my head. Could definitely be done for a low budget. But what's interesting about it, what's fun, is I've never written this way. I had like this initial sort of idea. This is how it starts. These two characters, they're in a car and they're driving. Where are they driving? I'm not 100% sure. Okay, they're driving here. What's going on here? There's something weird going on here. Okay, maybe it's something like this. Maybe. And then I just started writing. And what's been really interesting about it, which I don't suggest writing like this or anything like that. It could end up being horrible. It's almost an experiment that I just did for whatever reason. But it's like every night I'm writing for about an hour in bed before I fall asleep. And every night I'm kind of excited to go write because I don't know what's going to happen next. And I keep leaving off on these moments where it's like, oh, well, what's John going to say to her now? How is he going to respond to that? Guess I'll find out tomorrow when I'm writing. And I go to sleep. And then I don't let myself think about it or plan. I just sit down and I follow these characters in the story and where it's going. It's been just a lot of fun. It's a very interesting exercise. I don't know why I'm bringing this up, but that's currently
that's cool.
What I'm doing.
Well, you know, it's interesting you say that because rumor has it John Williams composes 1 to 3 minutes of new music every day just to keep his chops up. He doesn't need to do that. That's really what a composer friend of mine told me. So that's kind of along the lines of what you're doing. You're just constantly writing. I love that.
Yeah, I have so many openers. I've written so many just opens to things that I'll never do any. Well, maybe you never know, because a lot of these like little moments that I've written just scenes like, hey, you know, it'd be a cool scene. And I just wrote it real quick and I leave it in my little folder called ideas. And a lot of my stuff have like Tell was like three different things that I had ideas for. And I plucked them all and put it all together and fit it to this thing I was trying to do. So a bunch of the stuff that I even Action Month. Bar Brawl had moments of stuff that I've written before and I just plucked it out and put it in there. So I do steal for myself constantly. But yeah, it's a fun exercise. If you're kind of stuck in writing or, you know, writing a feature seems scary to you, I would suggest it. Just start, just vomit out a story and just keep going.
I love that. So there's no wrong, I mean, you don't go back and recreate or rewrite anything. It's just whatever happens, happens.
Yeah, and it could end up being absolutely terrible, but so far I've already, you know, written a few things within it that I'm like, man, I really dig that. If nothing else, I'm definitely taking that and using that at some point. So it's been a really interesting exercise, and something I don't write a ton of is dialogue. I even get made fun of for that. Some people have said I borderline make silent movies when I make my short films. So something I've been trying to shift is adding more dialogue and stuff. And that's one thing with this. It's like all dialogue. So it's been a fun exercise.
I can see where they're saying, but I truly absolutely love the dialogue that you wrote in Portal Kombat. I think, like I said before, the banter between Emily and Josh is just unreal.
It's great.
You really can't, you just can't force that, you know?
Yeah, and that with comedy, I usually do what I call ad-lib writing, which is kind of what I'm doing right now with this like experiment. The difference is this one's not comedy, and it's this. It's like there's mysteries involved with this like potential feature that I'm currently writing. So it's totally different to ad-lib write that. But when it comes to comedy, I like to, especially when it's dialogue and back and forth, I like to just write fast and whatever comes to my head, and it's almost like just improv in a way. And for me, that's one of the only real ways I'm able to write like that. Like if I think too much about it, it's never funny. So I kind of have to go with that, like sort of ad lib writing.
Yeah, that's great.
Someone here asks, hold on, if comments going by crazy. Any thoughts on pulling focus when you are the DP and the actor, quote unquote, shooting by yourself?
When you're the DP and the actor? You get someone to pull focus for you.
Excuse me,
that's the answer, man. The only other answer is autofocus, but never, ever, never, never, never. I mean, if you have to, some cameras, I think there was the A7S II for sure, and the C300 Mark II and the C100 Mark II have really, really solid autofocus. So you can use that to some extent if you have to, but man, just find somebody who can pull focus for you.
So yeah, you've taught your whole family. I mean, you went to film school and then you divided that film school knowledge by 10.
I mean, when we did Tell, all the people that I had help me had never done anything like that before. I had done a few short films, but most of them hadn't really helped me on it. So before we shot Tell, I sat with them and was like, you know, here's your job. And then I just trained them. And I'm like, hey, are you free Saturday for me to come over and us to like break down what a script supervisor is? Yeah. Okay, cool. And I buy them lunch and then we just go through and I train them what a script supervisor does, how to fill out the paperwork, what to follow, what to look for. Same thing with every job at the time, because I didn't have any network at the time of people that I could, you know, call out to come and be involved. So that's how I had to do it. So I was like, you know, let me put them through little mini film schools as far as what I knew at the time, so they could better, you know, help the production.
That's amazing. See, you're slacking in the studio. You're slacking.
I need to do more. You're going to have to come train me.
Just kidding. What would you say? We've gotten this question several times, and someone just, Matt just said, he thinks that what you're doing is amazing. You're helping inspiring the next generation of filmmakers, which is absolutely true. What you guys are doing is beyond amazing. What would you say to 21-year-old Ryan right now?
You have no idea what you're talking about. Just keep making stuff and your ego will pop very soon. Yeah, 21-year-old Ryan was had a touch of film snobbery to him, because I was like fresh out of film school. So, you know, I don't think I was ever too egotistical, but I don't think you really know if you are unless you have people to tell you, which now I'm online, so plenty of people are ready to tell me whenever I'm wrong on anything. But I definitely had a little bit of film snobbery at the time. And it's like I said, it's like you learn a little bit of anything and you kind of get cocky about it until you learn enough of it to know how very little you know about that. Filmmaking is no different. So, you know, I was like a little, hey, I went to film school. I know what makes a good movie. And then I made one and I was like, I need practice. So yeah, I mean, you know, just keep going. It's a lot of things I say to a lot of talented kids that I see. They send me their stuff and they want all this in-depth like critique. And I'm cautious on how much I give because, you know, they're getting it from my perspective. And I don't know if my view on how to make something is right for them. So I'm very cautious on how I give stuff. And usually it's, you know, keep going, man. You know, good job. Keep it up. More. Do more. Keep making things. Constantly be making things. So, that'd be the advice that I'd give cocky 21-year-old me.
So is that your advice for people who want to not necessarily follow in your footsteps, but build a YouTube brand or build a community is just to continually make content?
I think that's the wrong way to think about it. Even like if you want to, as far as filmmaking goes, I mean, I don't know about other avenues. There's definitely, when it comes to Triune, there's definitely, you know, your typical business type stuff where you have to market, you have to find your demographic. But that stuff came later. That was not what I was thinking in the beginning. I mean, a part of it was like, you know, let me try to build something where anyone will care at all that I'm putting out a short film. That was definitely a thought, but that wasn't why I was doing it or my main focus. My main focus was I want to make stuff. And I want to put it out there and I want people to see it. I want them to comment on it, you know, and it wasn't about like how many views I can get. It's like, how good can I make this? What's the best idea? What am I excited about? And just get excited about making things. And I think the, not all the stuff, but the majority of stuff that you see online that's getting traction, it's people thinking differently and doing stuff different. I mean, look at Freddie Wong. You know, the way that they started was clearly just a bunch of dudes who really loved doing the stuff that they were doing and having a lot of fun and then putting it online. And that's exactly how I started online. By the time we started doing Film Riot, I already had a little bit of a taste of viewership and stuff. I had put stuff on through Alienware and I did stuff through my own channel from an old filmmaking show that turned into Film Riot. So I had a little bit of that going already, but that's not why I started any of that. I started that just because I was like, you know, it'd be fun. You know, it'd be cool. You know what I mean? And then I followed that. I'm never going to make a film because it's like, hey, this is going to make a lot of money. I hope not anyway. I hope that like I never become that. Yeah. You know, if I'm going to spend a bunch of time on a short film or a film in general, it's going to be because I get really excited about that project and I really want to do it. I'm like, we're working towards doing something cool for October right now. And it's not like this is this in-depth story. It's another scene type thing. But I'm really excited about doing it. There's stuff in it that I cannot wait to shoot and edit. And it's not, oh, man, this is definitely going to get a million views. It might not. I mean, I think that's a reason why we don't have a billion, like most of our videos with a million views is because I never go after this is what's super popular, let's do that. I just follow what I'm excited about because that's the only way I know how to make things. I can't make something because I think it's going to make a million views. I think that's I mean, you know, I'm not going to say that's the wrong way to do it, because I'm sure there's people that do it that way and they're very, very successful and happy. But that's not how I operate. I have to follow, you know, what I'm excited about. And, you know, that doesn't often lead to a million views. Because, you know, you have that niche of people who are excited about what you're excited about, but, you know, oftentimes not. So, you know, that's how I would look at it, is, you know, stop looking at success in dollar signs and audience count, and start looking at it as, what did I learn from the last one to this one? You know, have I progressed in what I want to become? And I think when you start looking at success like that, did I entertain someone? You know, it's a lot different, and that helps you keep going. I think a lot of people get burnt out because they're like, still not cracking 1,000 views, still not cracking 10,000, not cracking 100,000. It's like, man, right. Don't look at it like that. You know, because we've had stuff that didn't do a lot of views, but I'm still proud of it. You know, I mean, I think Bar Brawl was my favorite of the bunch from Action Month, and I think that one has some of the least views of the bunch, but I'm still most proud of that one.
That's a great one.
So,
and Tim makes one hell of a bartender.
So, he does. He's menacing looking, man. Yeah. So I think that's the thing, is, you know, don't do it for views or audience. Do it because you love it, and more than likely the audience will come. And something that Ryan Vance told me when we first started was, you know, just be diligent, keep going, be passionate, do your thing. Don't worry about it. The cream rises to the top. So, you know, if you have the talent and you're doing original cool stuff with an original voice, that's not in an oversaturated market, you know, don't try to be Film Riot when there's already a ton of shows like Film Riot now. You know, right. At the time there wasn't, which is why I started it. You know, don't try to be Variant when now there's 100 types of shows. Like, at the time that we started Variant, there really wasn't. So it's like, you know, what do you wish existed? Go make that thing. Do that. And then see what happens.
I love that. We've got a lot of questions that kind of fall into that. Have you ever woken up, whether it was early on or now, you ever wake up and go, man, is this thing ever going to click for us? I doubt that now so much, but back in the day, when the very, very early days, did you ever just go, wow, I'm not sure what I'm doing, or I don't feel motivated, or I don't feel like my creativity is where it needs to be?
As far as Film Riot goes?
I mean, Film Riot, and your career and Film Riot are intertwined. Did you ever... Like in the early days of Film Riot, did you ever think to myself, what are we doing? Or did you ever feel like a lack of motivation?
No.
Awesome.
No, not at all. It was in the early days of Film Riot, it was, I can't believe anyone cares.
This is awesome.
I can't believe I'm getting to do this. This is amazing. And you know, that's still there. As my career progressed, there's definitely, you know, the natural tendency to fall into, you know, when is it going to happen? When am I going to make that feature? When am I going to, you know what I mean? Like, you do end up feeling like you're just beating your head against a wall. And you get a lot of people asking questions like, why aren't you just making a feature? As if it's so easy. When it's not. It's like, you know, I don't want to make a bad movie. You know, and if this idea that I have is going to take $500,000, I can't make it for $50,000. You know what I mean? Of course, maybe there is a movie I can make for 50, but I don't have that idea yet. So there is that, you know, avenue of, you know, how do I make this work? How do I make this happen? And then you have this beast of a career that you created that kind of runs your life a little bit. It's like, man, how do I balance that? How do I keep this wheel spinning and make the feature too? And so I have those sorts of things. But, you know, in the beginning, I was just stoked. I was like, this is great. I'm making stuff. And I still feel like that, man. Like me, Josh, and you know, now Justin is working with me, who's stupid talented as well. Man, we say it all the time. It's like, can you believe we get to do this? Like Stark too. Like, can you believe this is what we do for a living? Like, it's just excited. It's just, you know, we get to have fun and make the stuff we want to make. And again, and if I think that's what you're pursuing, I think you know, I credit a lot of success to just that. Which, I mean, it's not like I'm saying I'm smart or anything in the beginning. That's not why I did it. I was just stupid enough to just continue having fun and not think about it. You know what I mean? And not worry about dollar signs at the time, which was also easier because I didn't have a wife and kid. So it was really easy to be like, well, if I live out of my car, I live out of my car. You know?
Yeah, you can't make that suggestion nowadays.
Right. Now I can.
So you've been in your studio for what, 4 or 5 months now?
Let's see.
Was the
something like that?
Was the Dragon included like in the lease, or was that extra?
No, okay. We've always had that. We just kept it in catacombs because we didn't have a place to put it. So we were pretty stoked, and Tyrion let it out, and now it's doing
it. I think there was the reference to something there. So I could talk to Ryan all night, but he has a family and a work life. So he's been very generous for dragging this on or dragging along with us. If you all have any last minute questions, hit us up real quick. Otherwise, we're going to wrap this up because, I'm going to get a huge bill from Ryan. So
otherwise, goodbye.
Mic drop. I'm out.
I'm done here.
Mike Thomas has a great question. Real quick, he goes, hold on, scrolling. Have you ever hit a motivational rut, and do you have any remedies for it?
I haven't, because as I've said to people before, deadlines are the ultimate motivator. So I've had the fortunate and unfortunate deadline looming over my head for the past 6 years, which at times can be very, very frustrating when you're trying to do, bigger things like, the recent one, Action Month, that I keep bringing up is like when you're trying to do bigger stuff like that, and it ends up hurting them a little bit because you have all these other deadlines. But at the same time, I'm never without motivation or never working towards some new idea because I have to. I have 2 episodes due every single week. If I feel like probably if I didn't have that imposed deadline, I would have a self-imposed one, which I do with our short films, because I have a tendency to just either procrastinate or because I'm nervous. Like if I have to write something often, if I'm being totally honest, it'll be hard for me to stop because I'm afraid that it's going to be bad, that I'm going to do a bad job. You know what I mean? And it's hard to get started on that first page because it's like, man, this is going to suck. I really like this idea and I don't want to ruin it. So it's like that fear kind of gets in my way a little bit and I end up procrastinating and not getting to it because I'm worried that it's just going to suck. So when I have these imposed, talk to sponsors or partners or whatever, to where you have to, this short film has to shoot on this date and it has to be done by this date. Well, I have to write. I don't have a choice. And it helps me get past those things. So I find ways to impose, even when it's not that weekly show, when I'm doing outside stuff like that, to impose like a, hey, happening on this date, it's happening. So I have to write and move forward with, pre-pro. And that goes along with every avenue for me, like doing the shot list or anything at all. I have this like initial fear of, man, I don't want to start because I'm afraid I'm going to ruin it. So those deadlines help me get past that and also obviously motivate. So I think, if you don't have it, then impose one on yourself somehow. Announce that you're going to release something at X time and that'll make you
get it done. And wait for your users or your viewers to scream at you if it doesn't happen.
Right, exactly. I mean, even if you don't have viewers, tell your friends. Because then what happens if you don't deliver? Oh, figures. So it's going to make you look bad. So hopefully those things are going to help you, push yourself.
Do you find, last couple questions, do you find being an entrepreneur, you wear a lot of hats and you're in charge of a lot of people, but do you find that being an entrepreneur is a positive in your life, or is it just another thing you have to deal with that takes away from the creativity?
Both, yeah. Depending on the day. Because there's a lot to it that's creative that I like a lot, and then there's a lot to it that's not, and I don't like a ton. I pulled in people to help me do this thing to where it's like, I'm the final say on stuff, but, these people are running these avenues. They're, Eris and my brother Tim, they run Variant, not me. They pulled me in when they need me, which is very rare. It's basically their show now. And, I very, very little to do with it anymore. In the beginning, me and Eris created the show together. But 2 years later, pretty much had nothing to do with it. It's their show now. Merchandising in our store, Amber runs that. And at times, she's my manager. Ryan, you said you're going to have this product done. Where is it? So I've tried to create that atmosphere where it's not, you know, you're working for me, it's we're working together. So it's become like, you know, a really good partnership with these people to help fuel creativity. And I'm still learning how to, you know, really nurture that environment, but that's the environment I want to have and create. And these are people that push me and are waiting for me to get something done. So it's another motivator, more deadlines. But you know, there's definitely that crutch that it gives me, or that limp that it gives me in some avenues, because you have this beast that has to continue turning and you can't, you know, let it stop. But you want to go over here and you want to make this thing too, but you have to do this too, and you only have two hands. You know, it definitely has that aspect of it that gets a little bit difficult, but I think, you know, 80% of the time it's all good stuff. And I have zero complaints about it whatsoever, because it's also has freed me up to be able to make what I want to make and to answer to no one except who I want to answer to, which is the people I decide to collaborate with.
I would have to agree. I wouldn't trade being an entrepreneur for anything, really.
Nah, man, no way. No way. I mean, yeah, I, you know, work 15 to 18 hour days, but
much like jail,
I choose
I ain't going
to.
Back.
Kind of. I guess you don't really choose to. You kind of have to work the hours you do. It's less of a choice. But, and there's no sick days. There's no real vacation days.
Even if you leave the office, you're still working.
Yeah.
So I guess this is probably a good time to shut it down. I feel terrible how much time we've taken. Thank you for putting up with all the crazy technical difficulties. Ryan Connolly enough for doing this, for coming on our little show. You're an amazing human being. Thank you for sharing with us.
Yes, thank you so much.
Oh, thank you guys. This was awesome.
He says as he hangs up, he's like, note to self, kill Sean.
Never again.
Can't wait to see how many expletives my iPhone has.
Just kidding. Can you fix the shot for me? There's a wire in it.
I do have to say, if you never saw that wire removal, that was some of the most difficult wire removal I've ever done, and I loved every minute of it.
It blew my mind. You sent over the first shot, and I was like, where are the wires? Gandalf!
You're too kind. But it was truly an honor, and it was a lot of fun. I haven't worked on wires that difficult for a very long time, and it was a lot of fun. So
yeah, man, it was great.
Thank you for that opportunity. Obviously, there's links in the description here, but if you don't know anything about Film Riot, go to youtube.com/filmriot. Watch every single video. So just stop your job, quit your job, watch Film Riot. You will learn a lot.
I do not endorse this.
This message is brought to you.
His views are his own.
And if you tolerated us in this episode, there's other episodes every Tuesdays and Thursday at 9 p.m. Eastern. You can also go to rampantlive.com and check out our older episodes. They all don't start the way this one did. This one was special.
It was my fault, man. I'm cursed. I'm sorry.
19 episodes, never once had an issue. So
friggin' Ryan Costner shows up.
Let's just say I tossed a laptop out the window. There may or may not be a hole in, you know, right now. So we'll talk about it. But thank you everybody for watching.
Thank you,
Ryan. I owe you for life. I really do. So thank you, man. All the wires you need.
You owe me a life debt.
I'm an indentured servant to Film Riot. That's okay. I can be like that.
Come on my pirate ship. Let's go get booty.
Ryan, did they go get booty? Yes. Yes. Let's
do this.
Yeah, apparently it's getting late. This pirate ship is sinking now, so.
down the rabbit hole we go.
Thanks again, everybody. Thank you, Ryan. Oh, Josh Nipper just came in. Hey, Josh. He just came in. Highfall Wire Master. I love Josh's work.
Love Josh's work.
So yeah. Anyway, follow Ryan on Twitter at Ryan_Connolly. He has to throw the underscore in there. So Ryan_Connolly. If you go to the other one, I think it's somebody else entirely. So don't do that. It's not him. It's a fake Ryan. And thank you all for everything. Thank you for please follow us and like us. We're a small, tiny, tiny, tiny little company. This is it right here, just the two of us. And so thank you, Ryan, for dealing with us. And Thank you, everybody, for joining us. And we will catch you all, what is it? Today's Thursday. So we'll catch you all next Tuesday at 9 p.m.
Yep.
Thanks a lot, everybody.
Thanks. Bye.